Hey everyone, welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here today. My name is Nathan Kozel, and I'm the lead pastor here at Calvary. We know that this has been a difficult time for almost everybody, but we want you to know we're in this together. We're here for you. We're praying for you. And if there's anything we could ever do, please let us know. We believe that life is better together, and we believe that there is power in the local body of believers that's called the church. And so we're meeting back in person every single Sunday on our campus at 10 a.m. We're practicing social distancing and cleaning in between each service, the whole good hygiene thing. We want you to be able to come into our campus and worship God and feel safe and secure while you meet with other believers. Maybe you're at risk, a little hesitant to come on campus, or maybe you're just checking things out for the first time. We're glad that you're here for our online service every single Sunday at 11 a.m. We want to get to know you and help you interact with us in your newsfeed on your computer or your phone today. Let us know that you're here today, or even drop a hand emoji if this is your first time visiting. We want to reach out to you and give you a visitor bag specifically geared for you, and just as a way of saying thank you. Maybe you're struggling with something, dealing with something. We want to pray for you. And so drop the praying hands emoji in your feed, and one of our pastors will contact you to pray with you and for you. Maybe putting something on public social media isn't your thing. We've got several links on your screen today that you can click and get to know us a little bit more and let us get to know you. It's no strings attached. We just want to be able to pray for you. Thank you for visiting with us, and even connect with you and help you take your next step in following Jesus. You can stay up to date with all of our information and even small groups, events that are going on here at Calvary. If you go over to our website at calvaryweatherford.com, or you can find more information at facebook.com/calvaryweatherford. We hope this service is a blessing to you today. So why don't we go ahead and sing a few worship songs and then come on back and we'll have some Bible teaching. Thanks for joining us today.
Out. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now you're
Oh, Hey guys, this time we're going to continue our worship service with the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Here at Calvary Baptist, we don't just think that worshiping is just about singing songs on a Sunday morning, but we believe that God has called us to worship Him in all that we do. And one of the ways that we do that is by the giving of our tithes and offerings. It's by giving what God has given to us so freely and giving back to Him for His purposes and for His glory. And so if you would like to give, be sure to click the giving link above or go to calvaryweatherford.com/give, and both of those links will take you to our online secure giving center, and from there you can determine what it is you feel God has laid upon your heart to give back for His purposes, for His glory, so that the gospel of Christ can continue to go out, not just here in Weatherford but throughout all corners of the world. And so at this time, would you join me in a word of prayer over our offering? Father, we thank You for this day, and during this time, we just ask that You multiply these offerings in a way that only You can. Use these to continue to spread the gospel throughout all the corners of the world. Share the good news of Jesus Christ, who is crucified and resurrected for us. And so we ask that during this time, these funds, these offerings can be used for Your purposes, for Your glory, to continue to build up Your kingdom. We love You, Lord, and pray all of this in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Well, once again, we just want to say thank you for joining us. We are so glad that you are here today. If you're watching online or watching this later on demand, we are so honored that you chose to worship with us today. Man, I don't know if you could feel that, but there was energy in here. There was some worship going on. And I love you guys. I love that you came to worship. If you're at home, I hope that you were fully engaged in singing praises to your Lord and Savior. That's what we're all about here at Calvary Baptist Church. We just want to help you learn to love God, live for God, praise Him, worship Him, because we honestly believe that life with Jesus is better. And so I do want to make a quick announcement before I get into the service. We had a couple of AC units go out over the past few weeks. Several hundred dollars worth of cost repairs, and so in just a little bit we're going to take up offering. If you're watching at home, maybe you're not part of Calvary, but you're interested in giving, please click on that link, or if you're here in service, you can go to calvaryweatherford.com/give, calvaryweatherford.com/give. And anything that you could give toward that would be a huge blessing so that we could continue our ministries in a cool AC building. We have started a new series over the past few weeks called Restart. And part of the thing with Restart is we're restarting our church after this pandemic and the essential church setting that we are. No matter if you're at home or in the service, we believe that church is essential to your life. And so we've been digging through 1 Timothy. In fact, we planned these series out over a few months before we even get to it. But I felt like this past week that God, specifically the past day or two, God has been shifting and moving my heart. And I believe God wants us to go to a different direction today. Next week, we'll pick back up 1 Timothy, our Restart series. We just want to do a one-off thing. But I'll give you a teaser for next week. If you weren't planning on tuning in, I would encourage you to. It's probably going to be the most difficult passage that I've ever preached on. In fact, in our day and time that we live in, it is probably one of the most controversial subjects. The Bible addresses it in 1 Timothy. And so I'm excited about it, a little bit nervous. But I hope you check us out next week. Come back next week for that. But if you've been with us for any amount of time, I love to do something I call fireside chat. And what I mean by that is I just want to sit with you. I want to talk with you just one-on-one. I want to encourage you today and just have a heart-to-heart. I don't know about anyone else. Just anyone, if you're watching online here today, just show of hands. Anyone tired of the negativity? I mean, is this, I don't want to sound negative, but are you just tired of the negativity? I'm tired of the pandemic, tired of the division. People that are tired of the division are adding to the division. Tired of the economy, tired of politics, tired of news, tired of social media. Anyone here just tired? Tired this morning? And I don't mean that you stayed up all night last night binge watching your favorite TV show and so you drug in here this morning and you are physically tired. I'm not tired. You may be that. And I hope to keep you awake this morning. But anyone here just emotionally tired, spiritually, mentally exhausted? You ever just get sucked into all of the vortex of craziness and chaos and negativity out there? And it begins to unsettle your heart, or maybe frustration in your life, or anxiety, or anger, and you're just, you're emotionally on edge, like you just don't know if you can handle one more thing. Studies have shown that emotional abuse, physical abuse, and sexual abuse are skyrocketing right now. Alcohol and drug sales are skyrocketing right now. And I'm sure if you looked around the room today, there are people going through battles right now that you don't know anything about. Even as I talk about it today, your heart is heavy. And if that's you today, I want to give you some encouragement today. I want to encourage your faith. I want to give you some optimism for your faith. I want to give you some hope today. And so if you're ready for some encouragement today, why don't we just where you are right now, why don't you give me a healthy a shout out, just a wahoo, a yahoo, type that in the comments if you're watching online. But why don't we just, if you're ready for some encouragement, if you're ready for some positivity, go ahead and let that out right now. I don't know about you, but this past week I've been reading through the book of Job. And if you knew anything about the book of Job, Job was so discouraged by his friends. I mean, he lost everything. He lost his house, his cattle, his kids. I mean, the guy was going through a hard time. The guy was struggling, and his friends did know about it. And his friends came, and the people they were negative. They were discouraging. Yeah, Job, you messed up. You shouldn't have done this. You shouldn't have sinned. You brought it upon yourself. It's your fault. You deserve this. And that almost sounds like the world we're living in today. I mean, don't show your hands, but anyone in this room know of somebody that's just negative like that? I mean, you can't get two words out and it's just like, oh, I can't. And in Job 16, Job says this kind of sarcastically. He says, "What comforters you are, will you ever just stop blowing hot air? I mean, why do you keep on talking? I could say the same things about you if you were in my place. I could criticize you." You ever wanted to just, man, you're so full of hot air. You ever just wanted to say that to somebody? Just stop talking. If I was in your place, I could criticize you. But I love this. Job goes on to say, "But if it were me, I would encourage you, and I would try to take away your grief." See, I don't think we need more people in the world and in our church criticizing or judging or harsh or standing up on truth. And yes, we should stand for truth, but if it's without love, it's pointless. So today, I don't want to bring some negative, harsh message, but what if it were me, I would encourage you. And that's what I want to do today. I want to try to take away your grief, but not with the power of my own words, but with God's word. You see, there's too many negative attitudes on both sides of the spectrum today, and we need more positivity. We need more optimism. In fact, there's an old proverb, an old saying that says, whatever you feed grows, and whatever you starve, anyone know? Dies. There, yeah, that's right. Whatever you feed grows, and whatever you starve dies. And so the question is this morning, what are you feeding in your life, and what are you starving in your life? What you're consuming in your mind, what consumes your thoughts, will often play out in your life. And so today we want to feed on the Bible. We want to feed our faith. We want to be different. I've seen what the world has to offer. Anyone with me? I've seen what the world has to offer. And I don't want that. I want hope. I want difference. I want encouragement. I want an eternal positivity in my life. I want joy in life. And during this time when we need God the most, when we need faith the most, when we need church the most, when we should be feeding our faith the most, we have allowed the world and social media and media and news to dictate our thoughts. In fact, spiritual disciplines such as church attendance, Bible reading, prayer have all decreased over the past few months. And if you're like me, you struggle to go anywhere, look at anything, do anything, because you're bombarded with negativity. Bombarded with negative messages and fighting and complaining. I went to somebody's house the other night and went to talk about the Bible, and I ended up leaving discouraged because for 30 minutes we just talked about the news and the media and complaining. And when we went there with the intention of feeding our faith, we still ended up leaving discouraged. And so if we're going to have a fighting chance in this world, if we're going to have a fighting chance during this time, we've got to learn to feed our faith. We've got to learn to go back to, how does God call us to live? How does God call us to love? What has God called us to learn? What has God called us to do? And so that's my hope today. I want to feed your faith. I want to give you some encouragement. I want to give you some optimism today. So let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we come to you today, and God, we thank you for dying on the cross. The greatest news that we could ever receive is that you have bought our salvation with the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. God, if there's anyone watching this today, anyone watching in here today, may they learn the gospel, believe the gospel, repent of their sins, and be transformed. God, I pray for those that are in this room today that these truths might feed their faith. That, God, we would be encouraged by what you're doing in our lives. That you are for us, you are with us, and you are working in us. And, God, we love you so much. And we pray all of these things in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, I want to show you how God has started to feed my faith over the past few days. And there's three things that have fed my faith and encouraged me, provided optimism for me, hope for me. But these three things, please don't misunderstand me, these three things are specifically true of followers of Jesus Christ. Not if you're a churchgoer, not if you're a tither, not if you're your grandma's a believer in Jesus. But if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you follow Jesus Christ, if you are called a son or daughter of the King, these things are true. Now, if you are not a believer, there are some encouraging things for you, but we'll get to those at the end of the service. So I hope you stick with me, and I hope you learn, and it might even encourage you to open up your heart and mind to Jesus Christ today. And maybe it's for the first time you say, you know what, I want to be a faithful person. I want to be a believer in Jesus Christ. And I hope you do those. And if you make that decision today, these three things will be true of your life as well. The first thing that if to encourage your faith, that that will provide optimism in your life, that provides an eternal hope that this world cannot give. The first thing, if you're taking notes, is that my God is always for me. My God is always for me. You see, I struggled with this for so long, and I still struggle with this to some extent. I told you a few weeks ago that I struggled with always seeing God as a cosmic cop who's at a speed trap, and he's always just waiting to catch me in the act, waiting to catch me in sin, waiting to trip me up, to trick me into sin. And when I get there, he's going to write me a ticket. He's waiting to get me. And when I would do those things, I would have these spiritual mood swings. I mean, I would try really hard. I was going to be determined I would not sin. And then I would trip up into sin. And then I'd feel so guilty. And I would feel ashamed. And then I would try really, really, really hard, and then I would mess up again. And I'd have these kind of pendulum type mood swings spiritually. And it wasn't until I started to pursue Jesus, until I saw that Jesus was pursuing me, until I saw that Jesus loved me, until I saw that Jesus left 99 to come after me with the goal of redemption, not the goal to come and strike me down, but the goal to redeem me, to save me, to rescue me, to pick me up out of the clay and the mess and the junk of my life, that he loved me, desperately pursuing me, that he is patiently there for me. I read through the book of the Gospels, and every time I see Jesus encounter somebody who was struggling, who was hurting, who was living in sin, he was gracious and merciful and loving and patient with those people. In fact, he said that he came for them. And one of my favorite passages that talks about this is in Romans chapter 8, but in Romans chapter 7, no one talks about it, but Paul is struggling with his faith in Romans chapter 7. And I don't mean struggling like doubting or anything, but I mean he wanted to do what was right, but he was struggling able to do that. He was a mess that he wanted to, but his life didn't reflect it. And so in Romans chapter 8, after this struggle, he goes on to say that when you are in Christ Jesus, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, for those who walk according to the flesh, not to those who walk according to the flesh, but according to those who walk in the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life is in Christ Jesus, has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on the account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their mind on the things of the Spirit. What is Paul saying there? Well, Paul is saying that Jesus Christ's death did what I could not do in my life. You see, the only way to get into heaven and have a right relationship with God is to keep God's law. The only way to be a good, upstanding American country citizen is to keep the laws. Well, problem is we can't keep God's laws. And every time we try, we keep failing. We can keep 8 or 9, but we keep falling down. And if you break one, you break all. And the problem is that all sin was doing, or breaking the law was doing, is causing us to fall short. And all it was doing was condemning us. So what God did as a gracious gift to us, He condemned Jesus Christ for our sin. He didn't sin. He didn't deserve the wrath of God. But God crucified Him. For those who are in Christ Jesus, their sin is paid for. So we have a right standing with God, and that allows us to walk in life and walk in step with the Holy Spirit, to live how we were called to live in the very beginning of Genesis chapter 1 and 2. And so we're not living to gain approval of God, but we are living out of salvation, that we have approval of God in Jesus Christ. And so Paul goes on to talk about his present sufferings, that he is stoned, he is beaten, he is shipwrecked, he is left for dead. Talk about a bad, horrible, no good day. Paul was having that for a couple of years. And it says, Paul says, he knows the struggles, he knows the sufferings. So the question is, what is your struggle today? What is your suffering today? What are you going through? Are you struggling with a loss of a job? Are you struggling with a marriage? Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe your friend stabbed you in the back. Your kids are wayward. You got bad news from the doctor. What is your struggle? Well, Paul goes on to say that his present struggle doesn't even compare for what's waiting in glory. What's 80 years of a life of struggle for an eternity in glory full of blessings, that we can't even begin to compare our present struggles with God's future blessings? Well, the question is, how can Paul have this confidence? How does Paul know that it's all going to work out? Why does he know that there's present struggles and he can get through the present struggles? Well, he says it in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. We're going to read a couple of verses. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. Drop down to verse 31. What then shall we say to those things? If God is for us, then who could be against us? Right? My present struggles won't compare to the eternal blessings. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us, how shall we not live with him also, freely giving us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. For who he is he who condemns? It is who Christ who died and furthermore also risen, who is even at the right hand of God and makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Drop down to verse 37. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Somebody say more. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither life nor death, nor angels, nor principalities or powers, nor present things, nor things to come, nor height or depth, no other created thing shall separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. God is for me. Why don't we all just say that today? God is for me. On three. One, two, three. God is for me. If you're watching at home, type it in. God is for me. I remember when I played football and in school, and I was not very good. I remember I didn't really care about it. I mean, I love football, but I didn't like getting beat up. And I remember when I would hear my parents in the stands cheering, yelling, screaming for me, man, I played a little bit harder. But when my girlfriend was in the stands at the time, man, I saw her and she cheered me on. I knew she had my back. Man, I played a little bit harder. You see, when people are for you, and you know they're on your side no matter what, man, it makes you play a little bit harder. It encourages you, doesn't it? And what else could be better than God Himself that is for you and I? That He loves us. In fact, the Bible says there's nothing that could separate the love of God from you. If you are in Christ Jesus, man, that should be encouraging to you today. That no matter what you're going through, God is for you. But second encouraging thing is, my God always helps me. My God always helps me. You see, I really think this hits home for a lot of people. Because the reality is, if we did a poll today of Christians in America, if we did a poll, my belief is this. That a lot of us feel like God got us in a boat, rowed us out into the middle of the seas, rowed us out into the middle of the ocean where it was pitch black, the storms were rolling, the waves were coming, the rain was hitting hard, and He told us to get out. And He made us get out of the boat, and here we are in the middle of the ocean in the pitch black with the waves hitting the boat, with the waves hitting us, the rain coming down hard, and we feel like God just left us to fend for ourselves in the middle of the ocean. But the reality is that God has not left you. God has not left us. In fact, God is our help. He is for you. He loves you, but He is also your help. You see, the world may look out of control, but is still under the authority and the sovereignty of God. I think about back in when Jesus died on the cross, it looked like the world and chaos and evil was having its way. The disciples couldn't comprehend that the sky went dark. I mean, it was crazy, the scene that was happening. It looked like God had forsaken Jesus Christ. It looked like all hope was lost. It looked like we're still stuck in our sins. We're still stuck in Rome. We're still stuck with our everyday lives. We thought He was the answer, and yet where is God now? Oh, but in the encouraging, the hope, the joy, the life is that little did we know, 3 days later, Christ rose from the grave, overcoming the grave, overcoming death, overcoming the sin, overcoming the world, overcoming the devil, that He bought us back and we are redeemed. That is encouraging news for the hope that you and I are going through. If it looks like all hope is lost, if it looks like the world is dark, if it looks out of control, guess me, track with me today that we've been here before, but Christ has overcome the world. The Bible says, Jesus says in John, that in this world you will have trouble. That doesn't sound like good news. Couldn't you just say, Jesus, in this world you're going to have sunshine. In this world you're going to have candy. In this world you'll all the good blessings, health, wealth, prosperity. That's what I want to hear from Jesus. But that's not what He says. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. Why should we be encouraged today? Take heart, because I have overcome the world. You need to know today that the overcomer is the one who is on your side, who is for you, and who is helping you today. What area of need do you need help with today? In fact, this is echoed all throughout the Bible in Hebrews chapter 13, 5 through 6. Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you. So we can say with confidence that the Lord is my helper, and I will not be afraid. See, our God is for you, but He is also your helper. And it may not be how you want it, but He will always help you by doing the right thing for you. You see, some of you today are going through an incredibly difficult, hard struggle. Some of you are doubting the goodness of God today. But if you are a Christian and you look back over your life, you can see the faithful hand of God helping you, guiding you every step of the way. And God's not going to forsake you. He's not going to leave you. He is your help. In fact, Psalm 46 verse 1 says that He is our refuge and our strength. He is an ever-present help. Not a past help, not a future help in glory one day, but a present help. What you're going through presently, He is there to help you today. He is your refuge. There's an old song that we used to sing that He hides me in the cleft of His rock. The little cave, the little indention in the rock by the ocean where the waves are beating, the rain is coming down, and yet we have safety by the strength of the rock around us. And in this rock, we can regain our strength until the storm passes. And that's what God wants to do for you today. He wants to hide you. He wants to be your refuge. He wants to help you regain your strength to continue the journey that He has called you on today. And during this time, we need to lean into God. We need to lean into faith. We need to feed our faith with the Bible and with church and prayers. In fact, it goes on. I don't have time to explain it, but it goes on to say that Jesus is about to leave. And in John chapter 14, verse 26, He says, "If I leave, then I will send a helper." And then He explains who the helper is that He's going to send to us. And that is the Holy Spirit. You see, God, if you are saved, you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. You have God inside of you who has sealed you, who is your helper, who is your comforter. But a lot of us, as Paul was saying in Romans chapter 8, we don't know how to walk in the Spirit. We don't know how to live in the Spirit because we just keep living according to the flesh and according to the world. We keep letting the world dictate our thoughts. We keep feeding our flesh when God says, starve the flesh, feed your faith, and pursue Him. Walk in Him. Do what He has called us to do. God wants to help us, but often we're not willing to let Him help us. We're not given anything to work with. Lastly, God is for us. God is our helper. But God, lastly, number three, God is still working for me and in me. Listen, if you're here today and you're a Christian, God's not done with you yet. God's not done with you yet. In fact, I want you, that's so powerful to know. I want you to say that God's not done with me yet. On three. One, two, three. God's not done with me yet. If you're watching online at home, I want you to type that in. I want you to say that out loud where you are. God's not done with me yet. In fact, Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, being confident of this. Have you noticed how confident Paul is in the midst of his struggles and trials and chaos and of the world, the sufferings of the present world? He was really confident, and that word keeps popping up there. But being confident of this, that He, God, who began a good work in you, if you are saved, God began a good work in you, but He will be faithful to complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. What God has started in your life, He will be faithful to complete it until it is done, until it is good, until it is complete. And He is not abandoning the job site. You ever drive down Main Street? You ever drive down 20? You ever hit that construction that never seems to end? It just keeps ongoing and ongoing. And not only are you dealing with traffic, but you're hitting pothole after pothole, and it's bumpy, and it's frustrating and exhausting. Talk about negativity. That's what we're talking about today. And it always seems like there's only one guy working and 10 guys standing around. They're just abandoning the job site, not working on the job site. There was a a thing in Hudson Oaks where we kind of live a few miles down from us, and they were building a bridge, and the company just walked off the job site. And the crazy thing is that it's just nuts. But if you ever after, like right after they just finished that, do you ever just drive down the highway on a brand new road? And you can go 85 because nobody's on there. No one knows that it's open backed up. They got frustrated, so they went the long way. And you're the only one on the brand new road, smooth. You can go 85, no cops, no potholes. Man, it is nice. It is completed. It is finished. Listen, God is still at work in your life, and He will complete it. And when it is done, it will be perfect. He is not walking off the job site. And so you may be wrestling with doubts and worries and habits and hurts, and it has caused you to neglect God. But I want you to know today, God has not neglected you. You may not even see that He's working. You may not even know that He's working. But if it's not good in your life, if you're still here today, God is still working on your life. You are God's workmanship. And listen to me, God don't make no junk. Okay? He is definitely not finished with you, and you're not unfinished junk. You are a craftsmanship. You are a workmanship of the Almighty Creator of God. And what He has started in you, He will be faithful to complete it. I want you to know today that God has the final say. He has the final say over this world, over this country, over our church, and even your life. God is for you. He is helping you, and He is working in you and on you. And that should give you confidence today. Not because you're awesome, not because you can power through it, not because you can get through what you're going through, but because God is. That should give you God confidence. No matter where I go, God is there. No matter what I do, God is there, and He loves me. No matter what happens to me, my God is for me. And when you begin to feed your faith, you begin to grow and you begin to see more of God's power and presence and faithfulness in your life so that you can get through the next struggle. Listen, we cannot be a product of our environment any longer. We have got to be confident in the Almighty God. My prayer is that this encourages you today, but there might be some here today that says, you know what, I'm not in Christ Jesus. I'm not walking in the Spirit. I'm living on my own. You know, I'm struggling and I don't feel like there's help. I don't feel like God is for me. Well, let me tell you today, there's good news. There's great news for you today. There's encouraging news for you today. I want you to know today that God loves you so much. In fact, He loves you so much that He thinks that you are to die for. Because God could have left you in your sin, could have judged you where you are. You fall short of the glory of God. But the Bible says that while you are yet a sinner, Christ loved you so much that He died in your place. That He offers salvation to all. That when you believe in Him and what He said He was going to do, you turn from your sin, you confess Him as Lord, that means you walk in Him, you say, God, You are in control of my life. When you believe, when you repent, and when you confess, the Bible says you are saved. It is a miracle. A spiritual transaction takes place in your life. And the Bible says that today is the day of salvation. Romans chapter 10, verse 13. For whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So is that you today? Is that you? Would you want to call upon the name of the Lord? If that's you watching online or here, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads. And I'm going to say these words very slow, but how do you call upon the name of the Lord? You do that in prayer. You talk to God. You tell Him what's on your heart. You tell Him that you believe, that you repent, you're sorry of your sins, and you confess Him. God, You are in control of my life. And I'm going to ask you to repeat this prayer after me if that's you. And the Bible says when you do that, when you mean it with your heart, the Bible says that you will be saved. So let's just pray. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I know that I don't deserve life. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to take my place, to die on a cross for my sins. God, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. Make me a new person. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey guys, if you just prayed that prayer with Pastor Nathan for the first time, we want to celebrate with you because we want you to know that not only is your life right now changed, but your eternity has changed as you can hold fast the promise that for all of eternity, you'll get to worship God, you'll get to worship Christ, and that there's nothing that can separate you from Him. And so during this time, if you just pray that prayer, be sure to click the next step link above or drop a cross emoji below, and one of us will be reaching out with you. We want to walk alongside you. We want to equip you with resources so that you can walk with Christ, not just today, but for a lifetime. And so we want to walk alongside you during this time. At the same time, if you find yourself in a time of need, in a time of struggle, or if you just need prayer, be sure to click the need prayer link above or drop a praying hands emoji and one of us will be reaching out to you to see what it is that we can be praying for, how it is that we can be helping you during this time. We want to help you out. We want to pray for you because we love you guys. And so just whatever it is that y'all need, be sure to let us know at this we love you guys. Thank you so much for joining us. And we hope you join us again next week at 10:30 a.m. And remember, life with Jesus is better.
What love could remember? No wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. See you.